The Isles of Scilly are an archipelago of some 55 islands lying 28 miles to the southwest of Land's End, the southernmost tip of the British mainland. Most of the tourists and visitors who travel there, either on the Scillonian 3 passenger ship or by air, do so to sample the quiet beauty of this seemingly gentle outpost of the United Kingdom, and remain blissfully unaware of the Scilly's dark history as a ship's graveyard. Before 1300, ships wrecked on the island's treacherous rocks mainly went unreported, but in 1305, an unidentified sailing ship came to grief on the second largest island of Tresco. This event was only recorded because the coroner, William Le Poer, was sent to the island to organise the salvage of the ship. Instead, he was set upon by a mob led by the Lord of the Manor and ransomed. Perhaps it was this incident that gave the Scillonians the unfair and unfounded reputation of wreckers that has endured through the ages. Over the past 700 years, countless vessels have fallen victim to the rocks and shoals of the Scillies. The wreck with the most valuable cargo was the Merchant Royal, who foundered between Land's End and the Isles of Scilly in September 1641, with the loss of 100,000 pounds of gold, 500 bars of silver, and 500,000 silver coins. Worth approximately £1 billion by today's values, the final resting place of the wreck and her cargo are still being ardently sought today. But it is the human cost of the multitude of wrecks around the Scillies that leaves the deepest impression. Whilst many people on these ships were saved by the bravery of the Scillonians, those drowned runs into thousands. As seafaring people, the Scillonians are well acquainted with the deadly potential of the sea as a workplace, and throughout the islands, there are reminders and monuments to those lost around their shores. The most poignant of these is the open-air museum of Valhalla within Tresco's Abbey Tropical Gardens. Here, carvings, figureheads and artifacts of Scilly's wrecks are displayed as a mute yet graphic reminder of these many disasters. The entrance to Valhalla is dominated by this cannon, which came from the famous wreck, the HMS Association, who sank with three other Royal Navy ships after striking the Western Rocks on the 22nd of October, 1707. With the loss of up to 2,000 lives, it remains one of Britain's worst naval disasters. Among the dead were Admiral Sir Cloudesley Shovel, who was commanding the fleet on the HMS Association, and his two stepsons. Unsurprisingly, myths soon sprang up around this disaster. One was that a crewman, who tried to warn the Admiral of impending disaster, was immediately hanged from the yardarm for insubordination. Another was that Shovel was washed up alive on this beach at Porthelic Cove on St. Mary's, but was then murdered for his emerald ring by two local women. Despite the lack of any concrete evidence, both stories grew legs, as they say. After all, why spoil a good tale for the want of the facts? Today, the spot where Shovel's body was found is marked by this monument. The Admiral was originally buried here before being moved to the grander surroundings of Westminster Abbey. His two stepsons, Sir James and John Narborough, who also perished in the sinking of the Association, are in the churchyard of St. Mary's Old Church on the main island of St. Mary's. But no monument exists for the 1,500 to 2,000 able seamen who also died in the disaster. Those bodies that were washed up were buried in unmarked graves, mainly on the Isle of St. Agnes. A combination of incorrect navigation, particularly determining longitude, faulty compasses, poor weather, and visibility put the Association and the other three doomed ships in exactly the wrong place at the wrong time, with such tragic results. It was largely as a result of this disaster that the Board of Admiralty instituted a competition for a more precise method to determine longitude. John Harrison, a self-taught carpenter, won the prize of £20,000, worth just under £3 million today, with his invention of the first marine chronometer to calculate longitude accurately at sea. But despite this major advance in the sea navigation, the rocks of the Scillies would continue to claim ships and the lives of their crews until the present day. In the 19th century alone, hundreds of vessels came to grief on Scilly's shores, as the carvings and figureheads at Valhalla bear testament. This sailor with his sword drawn was salvaged from the Palinurus, which sank off White Island, St. Martin's, in a December storm in 1848. She took 17 crew to the bottom, along with her cargo of rum. And this figurehead of Russian Tsar Alexander I came from the Italian ship Alessandro il Grande, who sank on the Mare ledges to the south of Tresco in 1851. Whilst the ship was lost, all her crew miraculously survived, once again thanks to those wreckers and pirates, the Scillonians. A short distance from the actual museum is the figurehead that came from the paddle steamer the SS Thames, who ran aground on the Cribwidden rocks travelling from Dublin to London. Only 4 of the 65 on board survived. Like so many before and after her, her crew mistook the St. Agnes lighthouse for the Longship's lighthouse, with tragic results. The ageless tradition that ships are always female is also well represented by many of the figureheads in Valhalla, such as this mysterious lady clasping a rose. Nothing is known of the vessel from which she came. This finely carved woman's head that adorns one of the columns at the museum is what remains of the figurehead of SS Falkland, a four-masted bark that sank on Bishop's Rock in a storm in 1901. While several of her crew sadly died, 2 passengers and 21 crew were brought to safety with the help of the St. Agnes lifeboat. This figurehead was salvaged from the River Lune, impaled on the rocks of Annet on the 27th of July 1879. The bark Maypoo was wrecked on the rocks of Briar on the very same day. Of the 100 or so vessels that sank on Scilly's over the next 90 years, the oil tanker, the Torrey Canyon, that hit the Seven Stones rocks in 1967, is easily the most infamous. Her cargo of 120,000 tons of oil spilled out of the stricken vessel to cause an ecological disaster along the coasts of England, France and the Channel Islands on an unprecedented scale, killing thousands of seabirds and sea life. There are a number of reasons the beautiful islands of the Scillies have proved so lethal to so many ships over the centuries. Firstly, their geographical position at the entrance to the English Channel means that they are a natural trap for any vessel whose master has miscalculated her position. This was certainly the case with Sir Cloudesley Shovel and the 3 ships with the Association. In that tragedy, navigational error was compounded by the northward drift of the Rennell Current that flows up from the Bay of Biscay, across the entrance of the English Channel and into the Irish Sea. Although its northward drift is only a knot an hour, it's enough to lead the unwary mariner into the arms of Scilly's lethal rocks. The importance of the current was little appreciated until it was identified by the noted naval cartographer Major James Rennell at the turn of the 18th and 19th century, and subsequently named after him. It was this current that played a major role in taking the German liner Schiller onto the Retarie rocks on the 7th of May 1875. In spite of the valiant efforts of the St. Agnes lifeboat, only 27 of the crew and passengers survived. This monument to the 335 who drowned in this appalling tragedy is in the churchyard of Old St. Mary's Church. Fortunately, advances in computer and satellite technology have greatly lessened the number of ships being sunk on Scilly's rocks in recent years. Since 1997, when the German-owned cargo ship, the MV Sita, sank on Newfoundland Point, St. Mary's, no other vessel has actually hit Scilly's rocks or reefs. But this relatively long period, without wrecks, should not make us complacent. For the sea is an environment that often springs its nastiest surprises when we least expect them.